Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Your Market Navigator. My name is Bhavdeep Bhatt, and I co-head retail sales for Aditya Birla Sun Life Asset Management Company. As many of you who have logged into this session over the last 4 weeks that we have been running it, you would know that last four sessions we had dedicated to our analyst series, and from this week we are starting this expert series, wherein we have our internal experts as well as external experts come in and share their perspectives on market and economy with you on a weekly basis. Today we have our senior fund managers and head of research, Satyabrata Mohanty, with us. Satya has been with us for roughly two decades, and he has been managing two funds, one ABSL Equity Advantage Fund, which is a large and mid-cap category fund, and another fund is ABSL Equity Hybrid 95, which is our aggressive hybrid fund. And today we intend to kind of have just a conversation. There is no presentation, formal presentation setup. And over the course of next 1 hour or so, we'll discuss two main agenda. Of course, one is the macro part. Satya is one of the very well-read person on the investment side. I know, I mean, over my last 2 decades of career. So it would be wonderful to kind of have Satya's perspectives on how does he see as new trends emerging in economy, markets, and general investment space. And then we'll definitely deep dive into two products that he's managing. One is both the funds that I just mentioned. And we'll kind of have conversation centered more around the portfolio attribution of both the funds, so that you have greater insight into how does he kind of go about building his portfolio, and what are his key investment thesis, and some of the sector overweights and underweights in both the funds. So without taking much time, Satya, the first question I had, to first of all, welcome, Satya, to this
thank you
new series that we have started. Now, the first question to you is that of late, with markets doing really well, both globally and in India, there is a bit of a change in narrative. So people feel about, a couple of weeks back, there was this argument that this is a bear market rally. And people are now decisively kind of changing their narrative from that to now for the beginning of the economic cycle altogether. So how do you see the entire the post-COVID situation on the market side, both in terms of economic recovery and the way markets are behaving? I mean, it's really surprising most of the investors, seasoned investors, and of course new investors into the market. So how do you really see this entire development?
Yeah, see, now there is a lot of talk currently going around that there is a disconnect between the real economy and the markets. Well, the thing is that we have to understand that equity markets don't really reflect the current environment of it. Equity markets are all about discounting the future. And if the markets think that the future is going to be different from the current, they really don't wait. The market doesn't really wait for numbers to come back and then react, because the market will always look ahead into the future and anticipate events and react according to the expectations of what is going to happen in the future. So you have to see that the current bear market or the fall in the markets that happened in the month of March, April, and those kind of things. That kind of market is what we call an event-driven bear market. It was not a structural bear market or a cyclical bear market. A structural bear market, as I told you earlier, happens when there are certain segments of the economy where there are excesses and bubbles are created, and the market goes into a structural downturn. So that and eventually recovers from that when that particular segment corrects. And it takes a long period of time and very strong policy measures. So it takes a long period of time to come out of that. An example of that is the credit crisis that happened a decade back, more than that. Then you have a cyclical bear market, which coincides with the economic cycle. When the economic cycle heats up, then the monetary authorities come in and increase rates and tighten liquidity to control the inflationary expectations that go up because due to a heated economy. So that brings down the GDP growth rate and also brings down the markets. But this is neither of the two. It's an event-driven thing. And an event-driven, it's not, we don't have any excesses that were there in any segments of the economy. There is no overheating of the market. There is no high inflationary expectations that need to be taken care of. It just, the markets have fallen and the growth rates have collapsed because of certain events, that unanticipated event that happened. But the thing is that with enough stimulus, event-driven recessions are the easiest to come out from, and they're always and you come out from in the quickest possible time. And the thing is that here the event is a virus, and my view is that with an effective remedy in the form of vaccine or or treatment comes up, then if there is enough appropriate stimulus, both monetary and fiscal, then the markets, then the economy will bounce back and things will come back to normalcy. And that is what the markets are discounting, that maybe in the next 6 to 1 year, things will become normal and we'll be back to the pre-COVID levels. And if you see the kind of stimulus that has been given across the globe, mainly in the developed countries in the US, Europe, Japan, etc., the kind of stimulus that both monetary and fiscal stimulus that has come in was significantly more than what the market anticipated. And that is why the markets are factoring in that in future GDP growth rate will come back, and that is what it is factoring. So actually, in that sense, you can't say there is a disconnect between the real economy and the markets, because the markets are forward-looking, and the market thinks that because of the stimulus, the future growth will be significantly higher than what it is currently, and it could be back to pre-COVID levels.
Right. And I think, as you rightly pointed out, I mean, markets of today don't necessarily reflect today's economic conditions. Typically, market is ahead of economy or the corporate earnings by at least 2 to 3 quarters, as the research time and again suggests.
Yeah, if you see the way the equities are priced, as if they are discounting for a very, very long period of time. So a 6 month fall in earnings, 6 month fall in growth really shouldn't impact significantly because you're discounting a very long term for a very long period of time. So the impact of 6 months doesn't really come to a significant level if you use a discounting cash flow approach.
Fair enough. So Satya, I mean, you mentioned talked about this stimulus that, of course, markets have been kind of responding also to stimulus with the stimulus, the impact it will give to kind of bring back economic activities as well. So what time frame would you assign for our economy, for example, and even the corporate earnings?
Yeah. I can't hear it properly.
Yeah, I'm saying, as you rightly mentioned, stimulus will have its positive impact both in terms of economic activities revival as well as, in terms of the flows as well. So what time frame will you assign for the corporate earnings and the GDP growth to come back to pre-COVID level and surpass that? So I think, you think it's anywhere nearby or it's going to take some time?
See, it all depends on when the lockdown ends and across the globe and when you go back to normal activities. So normal activities only will happen if there is a proper treatment or there is a vaccine or there is herd immunity. I think it should happen after 6 months is what the market is estimating. So minimum 6 months is there when you go back to normalcy, when people go back to doing what they were doing earlier. So it should take minimum that time frame. But the thing is that as the economy opens up and go towards normalcy, you don't have to be completely normal. If you just take step towards normalcy, because then the markets will keep on reacting positively.
So essentially, you are saying by end of this financial year, we should be out of the COVID impacts. Essentially, we have given up 1 year of growth.
That is the expectation. We never know.
Fair.
Because this is not a physical thing that you can do. It's a biological thing, so we really don't have too much of control. If vaccines fail and if the infection gets worse, then the markets will again take a fresh look. But that is not the scenario that anybody is expecting, that the infection will become worse. I think
One.
after winter, the confidence will be much more because people are anticipating that in winter, the second wave of infection could happen in the colder countries. And if that is not severe, I think then people will come back to normal. So that is around another 3 to 4 months away.
Okay, fair. So, I mean, we just took a broad level view and specifically about your portfolio, sector weights, etc. When we once come there, we'll deep dive into your ideas about the businesses, which businesses have got impacted, which businesses are going to kind of come back faster, etc. But before that, just one question, Satya, that we keep receiving from our partners and investors both. Is that, and this is a question not to you, not only as our senior fund manager, but also as a head of research, that you know, between 2015-14 calendar year and 2017 calendar year, we had a phenomenal run in terms of our fund performance across across categories. Our equity funds were doing extremely well, and when it came, you know, 2018-19 particularly, which were you know, where the when the polarization was a big theme not only in India but globally, these are the times when across all most of our funds we did not have you know, good run. So one question where we keep receiving from our all stakeholders is that how come our all equity funds kind of behave together? Either they do extremely well or kind of underperform together, or most of them behave alike. So what would you, I mean, what would be your answer to our partners and investors on the call today?
The thing is that you have to look at it that we have an investment philosophy which is consistent across the fund house, consistent across the investment team. So the philosophy, it's not as if here we run different investment philosophies across different fund managers. We have the same process, the same research team. So it would be if similar strategies like large cap or a multi cap or a large and mid cap, which have similar strategies, ideally the funds should perform similarly because the investment approach and the philosophy that we are following is the same. Unless, of course, you are running a completely different strategy in another fund. So typically, I would expect that the main funds, like the large cap, the multi cap, and the large and mid cap, and the mid cap, and the tax and the balance category, which follow all these funds follow a similar investment mandate. And the mandate that we, as a fund house, the philosophy that we have is growth at reasonable price. The growth at reasonable price is the philosophy that we follow for all the funds. And that is why you see over a period, over a cycle, eventually the performance is similar across all these categories. Only categories which are significantly different, like our strategies in, say, our international fund, the strategy in our dividend yield fund. Those are completely different strategies in a pure value fund. So there you will see that the performance will not be similar to what the other main funds are. So that is one of the primary reasons. And the other question that you asked was that why the underperformance over the last 2 years compared to the previous years? As I said, we follow a strategy of growth at reasonable price. We generally tend to do well when the markets are broader. If you look at over the last 20 years, 18 years, the markets have been broad in the sense that the Nifty equal weight or BSE 200 equal weight, those kind of equal weight versus the real index has outperformed. So what it means when an equal weight index outperforms the index, it means that the market is broad. So but over the last 2 years, the markets became extremely narrow and the index started beating the equal weighted index by a large margin. So, and that was caused predominantly because of slowdown in GDP growth rate, uncertainty about what was happening in the financial markets, predominantly the crisis that we saw in the NBFC space. So typically when this uncertainty is there, the markets become narrow. But what we are expecting going forward and what we are seeing now is that that the markets have again started becoming broader. And our view is that going forward for the next 3 years, with because of the stimulus that is happening across the globe, you will see a scenario where the markets start becoming broader. And so in that kind of scenario, we think that our strategy of identifying stocks from a bottom-up approach by using growth at reasonable price method will allow us to pick up many ideas. Because when the markets are narrow, basically we're talking of around five or six companies doing so. Stock picking ability and skill doesn't matter too much in that, those kind of scenarios. But when the opportunities are large and the markets are broader, your stock picking skill, where you pick up stocks which significantly create alpha. So that is the time when we will do well. And that is where the markets, we are quite confident that is where the markets are heading that way.
Okay, great. I think it's very clear, Satya. Just to kind of rephrase and summarize what you said, we identify with growth at reasonable prices our basic philosophy for building portfolios. And as you mentioned, last 2 years is where the markets were very narrow, or there was so much of polarization, which is, by the way, is a very rare phenomenon. In two decades, typically you would see 2 years where markets will behave like this. But most of the times market will be broader based. And in long term, whether it's 5, 10, 15, 20 years period, if you see, markets have been broad based, where the equal weight indices have done better than market cap based indices. And these are the times when typically the GARP philosophy tends to do better. And that's the time when, very interestingly, last 6 months, I was just looking at the Nifty equal weight index versus Nifty market cap based index. And equal weight has started doing well. And it very well coincides with our outperformance, because most of our funds have come back very strongly over the last 6 months. And it kind of gels very well with what you just now said, that as markets become broader based, we have greater opportunity to do good stock picking, and therefore outperform the benchmark in respective funds. So I think it's a very valid point. And I hope most of our viewers today would have completely got the answer of why 14, 15, 16, 17 were not an exception. And they are generally the market phenomena. 18, 19 was an exception. And now we are out of that kind of market environment. Okay, now talking about specific funds, Satya, on equity advantage, one question we have, let me just start with the, because it's large and mid-cap category fund, the mid-cap exposure in the fund is going to be a very important factor for anyone to analyze portfolio. And if I, as I was looking at our mid-cap exposure in equity advantage fund, it's about 36% odd. And the benchmark that we have, large and mid-cap index, has 47% mid-cap. So we are somewhere underweight, 10-11% weight in mid-cap in our equity advantage fund. So how do you really see this small and mid-cap space going forward, and how do you really understand and explain the underweight position in mid-cap space right now?
See, underweight position in mid-cap space is that because the index has split 50-50. 50% large-cap and 50% mid-cap. So there are two relevant indexes for a large and mid-cap fund. One is a Nifty large and mid-cap index, and one is a BSE 200, BSE large and mid-cap index. So if you see the composition of both these indexes are different. Nifty large and mid-cap is a straight 50-50% split between large-cap and mid-cap, whereas BSE large and mid-cap index is a market cap-weighted index, where the large caps have a significantly larger weight than mid caps. So mid caps will have around 25% and large caps will have 75%. So at different points of time, both these indexes will perform differently. The thing is that when you have a 50-50% and you compare with that, anything less than 50 looks like an under. But as you know, as we have said that unless we're extremely bullish on mid caps, we will never go beyond 50% in mid caps. So, and I would like to add a small cap exposure into it. So small and mid cap both taken together will be around 42 to 43%. So if you take both of them together, we will go to around 46, 47 if you are extremely bullish. So mid cap, so large caps will be around 51, 52, and the remaining will be cash. So it's a going beyond 50, I think, will make it turn it into a mid cap fund. It'll start showing behavior and characteristics as a mid cap. In fact, as you move beyond 45, it'll start behaving, and you can't differentiate it significantly from a pure mid cap fund. So we don't want to convert it into a mid cap, and we want to have it as a
Director
large
of the fund, yeah.
fund. So it looks like we are underway with mid cap if you use Nifty large and mid cap. But if you look, if you use BSE large and mid cap, then you will see that we are overweight. So I think, see, at one point of time we were 35%. Now we are almost 42% in mid cap and small cap. So we are we might add a little bit more as we start gain more confidence. But I think at this point of time, going beyond 46, 47 is not what we're going to do, because it'll create significantly more volatility, and and it'll start behaving like a mid cap fund.
Fair enough. So essentially, what you are trying to say is the 35% anyways is the statutory limit minimum exposure of small and mid cap. And on the higher side, you suggest that we'll not go beyond 50% because then it kind of gets into that mid cap character of the fund, and we don't want to kind of breach that limit. So typically, our investors should expect 35 to 50% kind of exposure in small and mid cap in this fund.
Yes. Unless, of course, there is the GDP growth rate becomes extremely good and we turn extremely positive on the markets, which may happen, but most probably won't happen.
So mostly one should expect 35 to 50% exposure in between mid cap and small cap in equity advantage fund. Great. Satya, coming to now sector specific things, I think one of the things that I saw was a significant overweight to some of the sectors, and particularly financial services. So obviously, while that space kind of gives a lot of opportunity, and if the recovery happens, it will do well. That's our belief. But over the last 3 4 months, it has got impacted more because of the reasons. Anyways, I think mostly known. Would you like to kind of explain your thesis of why overweight financial services, and how do you see that space playing out for us?
See, financial services predominantly being banks and NBFCs. Say, our belief is, say, as the current overweight in banks and financial NBFCs we are around 1.5 to 2% overweight compared to our index. I still during the crisis when it was when the markets were falling, we had cut our exposure and we were marginally underweight, but we have added to it over the last 2 months, and we have an overweight at this point of time. I think India being an emerging country, a developing country, so in developing countries, the role of banking and financial sector in the development of the economy is significantly large when compared to a high-tech developed economy. So because you need savings which need to be lent out and then invested so that economic growth happens, and the penetration of financial services in a developing economy is significantly lower than a developed country. So the scope for increasing growth for financial services is definitely large. So in a developing country, in a country like India, if we are positive on the financial growth and if we're positive on the markets, we can't be positive the economy, and can't be positive on the markets if we have a negative view on banking and financials to invest. And especially well-run banks, etc., banks and NBFCs, we think The right time to buy is when the sector is in crisis. That is when you get decent prices for companies which are extremely well run and have strong franchises. So I think this is during bad times is a time when you get the opportunity to buy into high quality banks and NBFCs, and that is why we are over it at this point of time, and we might actually add further going forward. So.
But just one element I wanted to understand, Satya, and for everyone on the call, is we are having 6% kind of overweight in banking, and you are saying we can further add to it. Now, on the other side, we are really not seeing credit growth happening until such time that there is no credit growth, whether it's CapEx or personal loan growth, etc. How will banks make money? Because their entire model is kind of lending and then kind of receiving money back, right? So I'm saying if the credit generation is not happening, how do you see the revival in banking sector?
See, I would calculate the overweight considering both banks and financials taken together. If taken together, the overweight is 1.5 to 2% at this point of time. So it's not as if it's a large overweight. It's an overweight, but definitely most of other players are marginally underweight. So, but we are overweight. And as I said, it's not about what's happening currently. Currently, credit growth is not happening. But is what we expect is going to happen in the future. We think credit growth is going to come back as normalcy comes back. So that is why that's the main reason why we have invested in banks at this point of time. Not because of the current credit growth, but what we expect to happen in the future.
Another two interesting sectors that you are sort of overweight, Satya. One is chemicals, and another is cement, for example, and also consumer goods. So one thing that I've heard you talk about is this global supply chain getting reshaped. It will open up a huge opportunity for India. Would you like to kind of elaborate more on how do you see that opportunity? And what are one or two key themes that you are running in this portfolio, which people are investors and partners should identify with?
See, now people are talking of change in the global supply chains. Predominantly, say, and the largest manufacturer in the world which supplies across the globe is China. But people realize that when this COVID thing happened, what it can do if one area gets shuts down and what it can do to your supply chains. So that is why now they want to do China plus one as a strategy for sourcing of goods. So there are a few countries which could benefit. So India is one of could be one of the beneficiaries if proper measures and policies are put into place, and which we think policies and measures are being put in place in India. So India could be a major beneficiary. There are certain areas where we think there could be large benefits that could come. One area is chemicals and specialty chemicals, where we see India can gain market share globally. The gain of Indian companies, the market share of India in the chemical space was already happening before COVID crisis, and we think it will get accelerated after this. So that is why, if you see, we have quite a large percentage of our investment in specialty chemicals and the CRAMS side of the business. We think there it could be a structural long-term growth opportunity. The other area where we think is in pharmaceuticals, especially in the API side. The APIs market is dominated by China. So there is another, that is another space where India could benefit. And the second and the third one where India could benefit would be electronics manufacturing, because electronics is one of the largest import bills that India pays, and Make in India aims at reducing it. So now Make in India is not only for India. Now we are planning so that you have manufacturing capacity where you can service globally. So predominantly the chemical side, the pharma side, and electronic manufacturing side is where we think the early gains could happen. in India. So in that sense, we are positioned and as a overweight position in and specialty chemicals, and we have an overweight position across almost all of schemes and AMC and pharma, and we are overweight in consumer durables. Most of the consumer durable companies at this point of time import most of the things that they sell in India. So gradually they're being nudged to manufacture locally. So some of them, so all of, I think most of them will start manufacturing locally. And as that in scale, the benefits of scale will come to these companies. And also in the Indian space, there are companies which are into custom contract manufacturing. So those will also benefit, though we don't have significant, we don't have any position in those contract manufacturers. So I think the disruption or the diversification of the global supply chain will benefit India, and we will, and our funds, in our funds, we want to benefit from that.
Yeah. Then another theme that I have often heard you talk about is this domestic consumption is what you have been, or domestic cyclicals is something which you have been playing in this portfolio for a while, and it has worked out very well in those years, and it seems to be kind of coming back. So would you like to talk a little bit more about it? And also let me just bring in another aspect so that we can move to 95 discussion as well. Is the you talked about this pharma and how India will benefit with China plus one strategy being followed by most of the offshore investments. But in pharma, this fund, our Equity Advantage Fund, is underweight, pharma and IT both. And pharma in some way is bit contra because most of our funds are overweight pharma, but somehow Equity Advantage is underweight pharma. So your take on that, and also on IT side, I think that's also that you are underweight. In fact, some of your stocks have done extremely well, like L&T, Infotech, and I think this Info Edge, etc. So you have some wonderful stock picks on IT side, but in terms of sector weights, both these funds have. Sorry, both these sectors we are underweight Equity Advantage. So a little bit of
It's the theme that we're playing with, playing the manufacturing in India in the chemistry space. So chemistry space occupies two areas. One is specialty chemicals, other is pharma. So taken together, we have a marginal underweight in pharma at this point of time, and we have a large overweight in specialty chemicals. So if you take both of them together, we have quite a decent overweight if you combine both of them. So because we are playing a theme within that particular thing, we are not playing pharma as pharma per se. We are playing the outsourcing that will happen, or the global supply chain diversification that's going to happen, and we're playing that. So wherever we find well-run companies, we invest in that. So that is one. And in IT, we are actually overweight. So we have almost 13.5 to 14% in IT. So the thing is that if you see, we have some exposure in global software. So that's gets classified as non as global companies, and it doesn't get classified as software within software, but it, bring them into software, because I think that they're software, because they're global software companies. We have some exposure to Microsoft, we have some exposure to Adobe. So if you add them up, we are running an overweight in IT. So we think it's not only the Indian IT services which will benefit, but also global software companies will benefit because of the trend that is happening because of digitization and automation, etc., that's happening. So we want to benefit from both from the Indian IT services and software companies, which are the global software companies. So we are positioned in that. And in IT, we also have other things which we call tech companies like say Info Edge, etc., that we talked about. So so again, that is one space that the tech space is what we like. So if you add everything up, we have a decent overweight, and our stocks have actually done quite well on an individual basis. So
Okay, I think that's interesting. So essentially, two, three themes that you talked about, and we'll summarize it maybe towards the end of it. But let's now move on to our equity hybrid 95 fund, which you have started managing for the last 2, 3 months now.
Yeah,
And
three months.
we have started seeing some uptake as well. So just if you can run us through what are the key changes that you have made in the portfolio, and how do you intend to kind of manage it going forward as well, both on the equity component as well as fixed income component.
See, on the equity side, the way I want to manage it is that see, Equity Advantage Fund is a large and mid-cap fund. It got reclassified from a multi-cap to a large and mid-cap fund. Whereas 95 hybrid 95 the equity side will be managed purely as a multi-cap strategy. So it will not have will consciously not have 40% mid-cap as we have an advantage because of regulatory constraints that we run in. Here we have an open thing, so wherever, so it'll be pure stock driven because we like something, some company we buy, irrespective of whether it's a large cap, mid cap, and small cap. So there will be no conscious decision going to that. And plus, apart from that, for both for equity advantage and the hybrid fund, the strategy, stock selection strategy will be similar. The characteristics that we look for will be similar. Typically, we would prefer, I'll have a bias towards more growth, more secular kind of growth. So predominantly, it will be secular growth-oriented stocks. So the pure deep cyclicals will be much lesser than other portfolios that we run in our fund house or versus peers. And we
They
will
play
be
more of secular stories than cyclical stories
yeah,
in this fund.
secular growth stories, and we will look for proof of delivery in the past by the management and these companies. We will look for low levels of leverage in these companies. So we'll focus on margins, then we will focus on ROC and cash flows, those kind of things. And we will look at investing in companies that don't have significant leverage, much lower leverage than the peers. But what
Just to
happens
match
if
with this expectation of investors also, which is more of stable returns rather than runaway returns, because
But
balanced fund investors.
what happens when markets turn around in the initial 2 to 3 months? What happens is the cyclical high beta names which tend to do well. So during those phases that happen every once two or three time, once in every 2 3 years, during those times for a brief period the fund will underperform. But still, we believe on a longer term proper pure full cycle. If you take a full cycle, these companies, a portfolio consisting of these companies will do significantly better than having high beta, high leverage, deep cyclical names.
As someone had said that when you talk to fund managers or experts, no, market experts, don't only ask, what's your view, ask what is your actual investment. So let me ask you in the context of 95, what is your equity allocation? Because you seem to be quite bullish in medium to long term view.
There,
But it is.
the cap is 80% equity allocation. So currently we are at 78, almost near the peak. And if you see, if you ask where I'm putting my own personal money, my own personal money has also gone into equities. So predominantly it's equity because I believe this is a good time to change your asset allocation. I think because of the low interest rates that are there, I think it's necessary that we shift a little bit more towards equities at this point of time from our asset allocation.
Perfect. And thanks for that. I think that gives more conviction that both at the fund level as well as personal investment level, you are kind of going overweight, significant overweight equity, in fact, near to peak, so which is good. Talking about the fixed income component of 95, we had one exposure which is currently categorized as D. What's your expectation in terms of its recovery, etc.? I mean, a specific thing, if you can kind of give some guidance around that, that would be useful because that exposure is about 5.5% at current, sorry, actually about close to 6.5% at current NAV. So that's significant for people to know.
See, my expectation is I am hopeful that money will come back. It's not as if there has been a default in it. We have written it down. So my belief is that India will have a three-player telecom, will be a three-player telecom market. So as long as we are a three-player telecom market, I'm quite hopeful that we'll recover the money. So what investors should look forward to is that should see that all the downside as far as the fixed income side from the fixed income side has already happened. So you're not going to see any
Any
more
further negative surprise, yeah.
negative surprises from the fixed income side. So what can happen is only positive going forward from the fixed income side. So then if that happens, it will give a significant boost to the performance and we
Sorry, I think we lost you, Satya, but by the time Satya comes back, essentially the point he made is quite encouraging to all of us because the exposures, which is currently valued at zero, which is over 6.5% of our total NAV at current AUM. And if that money comes back, as it has not a kind of there is a 0 rupee overdue by that company to anyone in the industry right now. So there is a very good chance. And if this three-player telecom thesis, if it were to play out, then there is an embedded gain in this portfolio. Of course, with all the disclaimers, that it has not happened, we are not guaranteeing and all that. But just as a prospect, it's a good likelihood, and one can really look forward to it. So we're just waiting for Satya to come back. Meanwhile, I have got a few questions. I'll just also, and please keep posting your questions here on the call. In Q&A sections. So, and we'll over the next 15-20 minutes, we'll try to cover maximum number of questions to you. By the time Satya joins, just a small announcement that next week we will be having another interesting session, and this time we'll be having external speaker join us. So our debt CIO Manish Tangi will be in conversation with Sonal Verma from Nomura Holdings. And they will be in a conversation around macro and asset prices across different asset classes. And I can assure you that it's going to be a very stimulating session. So don't forget to tune in to the same session at 4 o'clock on next Wednesday. Okay, so Satya, welcome back.
Yeah.
So we're just talking about this fixed income exposure and the prospects that it has potentially it can have embedded gain for the investors who invest now or investors who kind of stay put until that time. I think that exposure is maturing by the end of next financial year.
Yeah, it's maturing, but it's see, but if things turn around, then you don't have to wait for maturity to for you to get the benefit of it. If the rating changes, if things happen, positive things happen, the ratings could change. If the ratings change, then things would start reflecting in the portfolio itself on the NAV. So going forward, the fixed on the fixed income side will it'll be a high credit portfolio. So we will not take credit risk in that portfolio at that point of time, because we are taking almost 75 to 80% as equity risk. So we would like to have we don't want to have credit risk there. It's fine as long as we take some interest rate risk now and then to benefit from the fall of interest rates and inflation that we have, but we would not like to take credit risk in that. So going forward, minimal credit risk, high quality credit portfolio. And equities will be pro growth, pro high quality. kind of names with a focus on cash flow and margins and those kind of things. So, and I firmly believe that, as we were talking earlier, I believe that because of the kind of stimulus that we have seen given by governments and monetary authorities across different countries, I think this kind of stimulus we haven't seen in the recent past. We haven't seen anything like that. And this time, every time we have seen, like earlier in 2008, the stimulus was predominantly monetary, and the stimulus went into reserves of banks because banks were in problem at that point of time. This time, along with monetary, we are seeing fiscal stimulus also coming in. So the combination of monetary and fiscal could be extremely positive for growth across for the world GDP growth. And this time, money is in certain countries, some large countries, are actually flowing into the hands of the common man, where money is getting distributed to the common man. So it's coming into the real economy. The stimulus is coming into the real economy. So, so there is. So we believe that it could be that we could be at the cusp of the beginning of a multi-year positive equity investment phase going forward. And we believe that most of the returns will be made in the initial phase or initial years of this current economic expansion that we expect to happen because of the stimulus that we have seen across the globe.
Great.
So
So Satya, let's take
that is why I've invested a disproportionate amount of my own money in equity.
inequities. Okay, perfect. So Satya, we have a few questions coming in from our investors and partners. One question is from Mr. Hitesh Kumar Toble. He's asking, I'm investing in ABSL Equity Average 95 fund since 2018. And there is a loss, and my wish is to accumulate maximum retirement corpus long-term horizon, which is 20 or at least 20 years. I'm ready to take a risk to accumulate fund for 15 years, and later on, I will shift slowly fund to less risky funds. Kindly suggest, should I continue to invest in ABSL 95, or should I switch to any other ABSL fund? So, what would be your advice for
It depends on the risk profile.
retirement corpus?
So it depends on the risk profile of an individual person. See, if you want to reduce risk and volatility a bit, then hybrid 95 fits the bill. If you're a first-time investor in equities, then 95. So if you have a lower risk appetite and you're entering the lower risk appetite, or if you're entering the equity markets for the first time, then a hybrid fund makes sense. But if you have invested in equity markets for a long period of time and you have a very large investment horizon, then I would recommend a multi-cap or a large and mid-cap fund, pure 100% equity fund. But if you have a 15-year, 20-year horizon, so you can come into a pure equity fund or a multi-cap fund. So I would distribute it between multi-cap, large and mid-cap, and mid-cap fund.
Perfect. Okay. So essentially, suggestion is based risk profile that you should take a decision. And because your horizon is like really long term, you are still wanting to accumulate for another 15 years. So then you need to really decide based your risk profile because 15 years is too long to kind of settle for suboptimal return. By any multi-asset product, you could actually invest in partly in equity mutual fund, I mean. And over time, as you rightly mentioned, you can kind of taper your equity allocation as you approach your retirement. But I'm sure there are very seasoned investment advisors we have, and you can reach out to our investment advisor and have proper retirement. Retirement plan built because retirement is too serious a thing, and it can't just be based on one product or two products. There has to be a proper, comprehensive, holistic plan. And I would strongly suggest that take some professional advice for building that plan up. Satya, another question is Mr. Satya and from Mr. Elston Manis. Sorry if I'm not pronouncing the name properly. Question is, Mr. Satya, I understand a good fund can underperform its index in the short term, say up to 1 to 1 or 3 years, but the hybrid 95 has underperformed the benchmark and peer group for 5 years. Kindly advise. Second question is on hybrid 95. What's your strategy? Is going to always be mid cap and small cap based investing. So, anyways, I think partly you answered that question, but really something that you are going to kind of certain changes that you are bringing in the portfolio, and what kind of message or reassurance would you like to give to long term investors in the fund?
See, what I would like to say, long term investors, if you look at the long term track record, everything was nice and we had an extremely good long term track record. Unfortunately, for a credit event that happened, contributed significantly to the underperformance. So now the credit event is past us. So we the only thing that we can expect is we can expect some positive surprise, and we recoup either the whole or a large part of the credit loss that that happened. If that happens, if that recovery happens, then we could see a significant change in competitive rankings, going forward. So that is one part of it. The other part of it is that on an ongoing basis, you can be assured that the fixed income part of the portfolio will be invested in high grade securities. Mostly AAA kind of names. We'll not take credit risk in this portfolio going forward. And on the equity side, you will find the portfolio structure not consciously moving towards mid cap and small cap. As I said earlier, it will be a multi cap strategy that will follow. So a large portion will definitely always be invested in large caps. So it'll be pure bottom-up approach that we are following, and it'll be more structural stocks that we will invest in. So that is what you can look forward to.
Yeah, I think it's a very well summarized, Satya, because we understand that the investors who prefer to invest in balanced funds have a particular investment risk and risk profile, and also some sort of expectations from the portfolio, and we are very well aware of it. In fact, if you really analyze our fund performance all the way till 2017, calendar year end of 2017, it was doing extremely well, and then there was a bit of credit crisis, some sort of polarization, which is once in a while kind of phenomena, which had hit the performance for calendar year 2018 and 2019, but as you would have seen, we have started coming back strongly. And Satya mentioned earlier that broad-based markets is when the investment philosophy that we follow, which we call growth at reasonable price (GARP), that works well. And that environment is kind of making a comeback in the market, and therefore there is all the potential for us to sort of come back with our long-term performance that we have delivered in ABSL. As the name suggests, ABSL 95 was the fund launched in 1995. And if you look at its track record, year-on-year track record, most of the times we have done extremely well in that fund. And what happened in last 2 years was just a blip. So Satya, I think most of the questions, as I see, have been sort of answered during our conversation, whether it's about sectors or performance or portfolio changes, etc. So what would be your last advice, and if you can just run us through your super calls, in ABSL equity, equity hybrid, as well as equity advantage. What are some of the things that have worked really well for us, both in terms of stocks, sectors, themes, etc.? And a couple of things which have not worked very well, but you don't really regret, because it's just a matter of time. And some of the things which you think you had not done. So just your experiences and top sharings on both the positives and not so positive side.
One of the things that worked recently was in the last 1.5 years, we had exited auto stocks completely. So that worked out phenomenally well, because there was significant correction in auto stocks. and now we are again re-entered auto space. The stocks, certain NBFCs that we invested, certain banks that we invested, we were quite early investors and we made significant amount of money there. So those are one of our biggest successes, predominantly stock companies like, say, Bajaj Finance and those kind of names. A big
This is so to be a mistakes maybe.
mistakes. One of the mistakes that was there was that during when the NBFC crisis unfolded, we had a large overweight in NBFCs. Apart from Bajaj Finance, also we had a lot of other NBFCs. And so, on hindsight, we can say that we shouldn't have had such a large exposure to NBFCs. So that was a mistake that during that NBFC crisis, it affected the performance quite a lot. So that was one learning that was there. So otherwise, our exposure in, say, avoiding construction and infrastructure names and focusing our plays on, even when we are positive on infrastructure and construction, we were investing in cement companies. So cement did significant, cement companies did significantly better than construction and infra. So that was a good call that we had. So those are a few things. Even
I
now,
also remember you had Aisha at a very right time. I don't remember when
yeah,
you
so we made lots of money in iShares, and then we
did.
bottomed. At this point of time, we don't have any exposure to iShares and both of our funds. See, I believe that as long as you target well-run companies with a 15% kind of top line growth and 15 to 20% kind of bottom line growth with good ROE, ROCs, and with a large market opportunity size going forward, and if you keep your return expectations moderate around 15 to 20% kind of expectation, then you tend to end up with good companies, and few of those companies turn out to be extremely successful investments, which contribute significant alpha going forward. So I think that is the approach that we are going to follow going forward, and I believe that will pay off.
Great, Satya. So now my last question to you is, as the head of equity research for us, and just one sector which you are most bullish on.
See, India, see, now that you are in the recovery phase, there are a lot of sectors that the problem when you are in the recovery phase is that you really don't know which sector you should invest in. Because in a recovery phase, everything looks good. Because everything comes from a depressed price, low earnings, where you expect the earnings will jump off. But if you take on a longer term basis, which are the areas that I believe shows a lot of promise for India structurally. I think structurally the consumer part is where we think India should do well. The banking and financial part, because I believe there's a huge under-penetration of financial services in India, and as we develop and as our per capita income grows, the opportunities to grow and financial services will be there. I know at this point of time everybody is negative on financial services, but I think that is temporary. I think there will be a great opportunity on the specialty chemicals and the custom synthesis and custom manufacturing side, either in specialty chemicals or in pharma or in electronics. I think that will be a good area to invest. And I continue to believe that Indian IT and Indian tech will do well. So we have IT services which we have inherent advantages, and we believe that it will continue to perform going forward. And a new segment will come up, which will be Indian tech, which doesn't have significant representation in the index at this point of time. We have hardly a few companies. Of course, Reliance, a lot of people see it as a tech company, so a large part of the largest company in the index is contributed from the tech side. So we and I think that going forward, as the digitization, automation, and those things and work from home become permanent, and the trends accelerate And I think the acceleration of trends on the tech side, on the digitization side, automation side, etc., which people are expecting will happen in the next 5 to 10 years, has been accelerated by this COVID crisis. So going forward, I think a large we will see a growing representation of the tech in the index, and which could have significant bearing on opportunities to which will provide significant opportunities to invest and create alpha. So
thank you, Sadhya. I think it was a wonderful session. In fact, I have learned certain things which I myself was not aware of, despite having a conversation with you one-on-one multiple times, because we are working with the same firm. So broadly, what you said is that you are quite constructive on the economic recovery, the stimulus being a very important catalyst, which will drive both the economic recovery as well as market side. You are very constructive on the segments of the market that you talked about, consumption, financials in general. You talked about chemicals. You also talked about cement, etc. So I think quite a few of these sectors that you are quite constructive on. You also talked about some of the changes that you have made in 95. So some of the investors who had questions on 95, I hope most of your questions got answered. Just to summarize the key takeaways in ABSL 95, currently we are 78% invested in equity. Our maximum limit is 80%, so we are very, very close to the peak level of equity exposure we can have in the fund. So that talks about our conviction on equity market as we speak. Sathya also talked about while we have a small and mid-cap in the portfolio, but he intends to run it as a multi-cap fund with stability as a core focus, because we understand the profile of investors who come into this fund and their expectations from the fund. He also talked about the key changes that he has made in terms of some of the thematic preferences that he has in both 95 as well as Equity Advantage Fund. We really hope that you kind of took away some inputs and some perspectives from this session, and which will be helpful for your investment decisions, both as an advisor as well as for your personal investments. So thank you very much, Sathya, once again for sharing insights in detail. Next week, please don't forget to tune in at 4 o'clock. Our debt CIO, as I mentioned earlier, our debt CIO Manish Tangi. We'll be in conversation with Sonal Verma. She's the chief economist, and she works for Nomura Holdings. Quite an eminent person in the world of economists. And I'm sure the session, that interaction is going to be very, very stimulating for all of you. I mean, with lots of insights in terms of actionables, both in terms of the economic trends as well as asset market views. So till that time, do take care, and good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for joining. Thank you, Sathya.
Thank you. You're welcome.